It's good to see you. It is good to see you. It's good to be here this morning. I trust that you had a good week. And even though you didn't, we're still thankful to God that we made it here this morning.
Amen.
He didn't have to wake us up this morning. Amen. He didn't have to wake us up this morning, and yet he did. So we give God thanks this morning for his grace, his mercy, and another day of praise.
Yes.
You know, when David said, I was glad to go into the house of God, you know, it's days like this that I think it is so fitting, at least for me it is, that when I got up this morning, and I look at the news, and I look at what happened yesterday and last night, and I get up this morning, there's not many places you can go with hope. But when you can go to the house of God, you know there is hope in the world. For those of you who don't know, there's a lot going on in our world. I know it's negative. We can't turn off the news, right? Because Jesus, you know, the Bible tells us about if we wanted to get out from the world, you know, we couldn't really, because where else would we go? We're here, so sometimes we feel like we're trapped here, and we want to go to heaven. But while we're here, we've got a job to do, and we can't tune out all the noise. We got to know what's happening so that we can help others. So this morning, just bear with me as I bring the message, because it's heavy this morning.
Amen.
So let's return to Matthew chapter 12, and we'll read from verse 46 through 50. Thanks to all the brothers who came up, especially my brother, the young brother there, who showed us, and powerfully read from the Word. Thank you so much. Matthew chapter 12, verse 46, the Bible says, while he was still speaking to the crowds, behold, his mother and brothers were standing outside, seeking to speak to him. And someone said to him, behold, your mother and your brothers are standing outside seeking to speak to you. But Jesus answered the one who was telling him and said, who is my mother and who are my brothers? And stretching out his hand toward his disciples, he said, behold, my mother and my brothers, for whoever does the will of my Father who is in heaven, he is my brother and sister and mother. This morning, I want to speak to you from the topic, who is my family? Who is my family? You know, we have an event coming up next weekend. Really excited about it. I know there are many planning, and I want to commend you for the work that you're doing behind the scenes. It seems like it's something that's happening behind the scenes, and everybody asks about it. It seems like they don't want to share too much information, so it must be something exciting. Family and Friends Day is next weekend, and so just come prepared, come ready to have a good time. We need some positive energy, and our families are needing it at this point. So, let's go back into the Word for just a few minutes. We'll take what it has to say, apply it to our lives, and share it with someone else. Can we do that? You know, we've been advised over the years not to speak of certain things in the church. I won't go all through a list, but I'm sure you know some of the things. Not to speak on social issues, not to speak too much on social issues, because we might rub someone the wrong way, and we might offend. Stay away from the political issues, they said. Don't address controversial things. Don't talk about certain things that may offend someone else. I believe it's a trick of the devil where he tells us, be silent and don't say anything. Whereas in the meantime, he is wreaking havoc in our communities, in our homes, in our places of work, in our churches. And he's working all the time while we remain silent. It's made us fearful of speaking up, fearful of addressing issues affecting our own homes, fearful of addressing issues that would offend those in authority, fearful of addressing issues and fearful of having a dissenting opinion. But Jesus came to shake all the systems up. But we follow Jesus and we have his name. And I just want to tell you this morning as I start that, you know, Jesus, when he came, he was at the center of a political system. His birth alone was an offense to those in power. You remember at his birth, he had to actually flee. His parents had to take him and flee. He became an exile because Herod sought to kill him. And there were those who lost their lives over Jesus' birth because they were afraid of the power that he brought. So he was an enemy to the political system. Not only that, but his message, where he says the kingdom of heaven is at hand. You see, we don't use that word too much these days because we don't live in a kingship. All right, but in his day, there was King Herod. Yes. And then as he grew up, there was the Roman Empire. Yes. And so if you said you were bringing a kingdom, it meant you had to answer some questions because you were bringing something that opposed what was already there. Yes. And so he had to answer to the political system. And in his death, let's not forget, he died at the hands of a political system. He died at the hands of the Roman Empire, who nailed him to a cross, a death that they reserved for criminals and for those who opposed the system. And he went up against the system, and so they had to take his life. The question is, do we still follow that Jesus? Is he our family? Because there's a lot of things going on in our world that so many are just so silent on.
Yes.
And forgive me if I come across as a little, you know, bothered this morning about some of the things, but I believe it's time for us to speak up. It's time for us to say something. It's time for us to do more. And not just do it, but let's show the world that there is a hope.
Yes.
I believe there's a battle going on, and I know it is. The prophecy is told. There's a battle going on against love and against unity. You don't have to look very far to see it. There's a battle going on against unity and togetherness and to welcoming others and to children, even children. Do you know that the federal government has children in court? As young as 4 months old? Who's come into the country because of political issues in their home country, and they come here and they're locked up. Hello, somebody. And the powers that be tell us to be silent about it. That it's okay. It's no big deal. But I think God has something to say about that this morning. We can't sit by and act like this doesn't happen. You know, I pulled up my Ring app a few days ago. There's an alert comes up at night, about 10 o'clock, and says, hey, there's a few people going around stealing. So be on the alert. I look at the app, and there's someone driving teens around. They stop, they run out, they grab things. At this one house that I looked at, they grab two solar lights and run back into the car. And then they drive off. And it looks comical. And you see it and you say, solar lights. That's what you're stealing. Another was stealing potted plants. Not sure what they were going to do with potted plants, but they were stealing potted plants. I just looked at the comment section and there were a few neighbors who said, you know, what's the big deal? They're just stealing potted plants. It's just solar lights. What does it matter anyway? And I thought to myself, this is one of the reasons why we are where we are. Because if the adults can say to the kids, it doesn't matter if you steal, then what do we expect from them? They say it doesn't matter if you steal solar lights, it's just a small thing. But we know that if you could steal something small, it's only a matter of time before you're stealing the big stuff. If you can lie about a little, you can lie about a lot. And it only takes a matter of time. And in this passage that we just read, the context is that Jesus is just starting his ministry. And his family hasn't seen him in a long time. I mean, he came down from the mount where he did the Sermon on the Mount. He picked his disciples and he's just been going and going and going. In Mark, in the Mark account of this story, Mark tells us that his friends came to get him. I guess when they saw that they couldn't get him, they sent his family. And normally, you know, if your mother comes, hello somebody. If your mother shows up, you know you gotta respond. And so Jesus is there preaching, and his mother shows up. And now he has to address them because someone in the crowd says, your mother and your family's outside. And at that moment, he has to correct some things. But just before that, in his message, he was telling us that our words matter. He was saying that if you are a good tree, you will bring forth good fruit. If you are an evil tree, you bring forth evil fruits. And then he says, it matters what you say, because he says in the last day, every word that you say, you will be judged by it. And so before we think that things don't matter and we could joke about everything, know that at one day, when I'm standing before God Almighty, we're going to have to answer for things we said and the things we did in this body. And so, they called Jesus, trying to get him to leave because they thought something was wrong with him. His friends came to him and said, we think you've lost your mind. That's what they said to him. He's going all this time, not seeing his family, not going home, and they think he's lost his mind. Well, I tell you what, I'd rather be with Jesus losing his mind and speaking the truth, that losing my mind and doing evil. Right. Hello, somebody. Right. They couldn't get through to him, so they got his mom. But you know, going on right now in our world, we've got to, as we welcome families in next week, we've got to acknowledge, first, we've got to acknowledge hurting families. Some of us are hurting. We've got to acknowledge the pain. One of Jesus' greatest examples was his compassion. His compassion. He could look at you and he could tell that something was off. And he would address your pain. I want to encourage us, Christians, do not lose your compassion.
Amen.
Do not lose your empathy and that love that God placed in your heart.
Amen.
It's easy to do while we hustle and bustle through life to forget what's happening to our fellow man, but do not lose your compassion. Because the day we stop caring, is the day when we've actually cut off from God.
Amen.
There are those. Wednesday night we had a good class. I walked in and we were studying the book of Micah. So happens, it's just amazing how the Spirit works. I had just read that scripture the day before. Because when you see certain things, you look for scriptures that could actually bring comfort and could help your soul. You need that. If you're trying to figure out the craziness in this world,
yes.
The madness, the chaos, the confusion, there's only one place you can go that can ground you, is the Word of God. Especially when leadership is void in our world. You need to go back to the Word of God. And I walked in and we were reading Micah chapter 2. And the verse that jumped out is the first few verses, 1 and 2. We say, woe to those who scheme iniquity, who work out evil on their beds. When morning comes, they carry it out, for it is in the power of their hands. They covet fields and then seize them, and houses, and take them away. They rob a man and his house, a man and his inheritance. I want you to look at that first verse again. Woe to the man, sorrow to the man, who schemes iniquity and who works out evil on their bed. It tells us that while we're asleep, while we're getting some rest, the enemy is awake, planning what to do with you the next day. And this is not only you read this and you say it's symbolic, but when you read what's happening in our news, in our world today, this is actually happening. That men lay on their beds at night and put out messages about what's going to happen the next day in a way that they could hurt someone else. And as I said, the battle is going on against love, against those who are oppressed, against children, against women, against minorities and minority communities. Let's be real, church. This is happening. And it's not a secret that is happening right in front of our faces. That men scheme to do evil and then they boast about it. The Bible says, do not rejoice when your enemies fall. And do not let your heart be glad when they stumble. Proverbs chapter 24, verse 17. So I ask you the question this morning. Is it okay that we stand by? Is it okay that we remain quiet in the face of all the pain and all the tragedy and the division and the hate when we have a message of love?
Yes.
Hello, somebody. I was sitting last evening and the alerts broke that there was a shooting, a mass shooting, in Gilroy, California, at a garlic festival. The shooter, who was about 19 years old, there was security around the perimeter. He cuts a hole in the fence with his weapons and goes in there and just starts shooting, taking the lives of three people who we did not know. One of them, a six-year-old boy. All in the name of and division. And while I was preparing a message and going over notes yesterday, I get word of another shooting in El Paso, Texas. People are out shopping at Walmart, back to school sales, getting ready to send the children back to school and just doing their daily shopping. And the shooter drives 10 hours through that location. Young man. He has a manifesto of hate as well. Now they're investigating for a possible hate crime. Words matter. I went to bed last night. I said, you know what? I can't keep my mind on this. God, let this go for a while. Get up this morning, turn on the TV, learn about another shooting that took place last night in Dayton, Ohio. 9 lives taken, many more injured. Yesterday, last night, 20 in El Paso. This is real. It might not be home as we know it, but this is real. This could have been us yesterday out shopping. With someone who is full of hate and full of rage over people he doesn't know because of where they come from or how they talk. He gets out there and he takes their life. And then I ask myself, where are our leaders? Why the silence? But I know God is still on his throne. And he gave us the message. You see, hate can win some fights, but it can't win the battle. Love has already won, but we've got to stand up and show the world that love is still on the throne. So we need it more now than ever before. So we've got to acknowledge the pain of hurting families. And then we've got to show them the family of God. Identify the family of God. You know, I was at work on Monday, and my coworker, I work in a big room, and there are a lot of people in there, and so sometimes it's hard to talk about what you really want to talk about. And it comes to the point where some of the people leave the room, and one of my coworkers is in there with me, and he could see that I was bothered, and I could tell he was bothered too. He started on the conversation of the shooting last week. And then he goes on to point out the silence or the consent of those who should be saying something and are not. And he goes on to tell me that he didn't know that I was Christian, but he could tell that I was a religious of some sort. He says, I don't know really what God you serve. He says, I used to believe, but I don't anymore. He says, I look at the world and I look at what's happening. I look at the division. I look at what is sown from the leadership in this country. And he says, it's just a coincidence. It seems that those who carry out hate and those who carry out division are also those who claim Christ. And I have to tell him, not everyone who comes in the name of Christ is actually from Christ. Not everyone who carries the name God is actually serving God. Because the devil can use that name as well. The Christians are being misrepresented as those who carry out hate and division. And the true Christians need to stand up and show that we are not represented by this. And these actions, this is not who we are. Jesus had the opposite message. and our leaders are quiet. The Bible says, not everyone who says unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven. And then he says before that, the same chapter, and it's just great to read Matthew. Just read Matthew chapter 12. Just before that, he tells them, by their fruits you shall know them. We can't have hate on one hand and expect unity on the other. That's not how it works. It never happened. We can't love on one hand and expect hate. Love only produces life. Hate, the Bible tells us, and James breaks this down very well. When he tells us that lust, when it has conceived, or the desire in a man's heart, when it has conceived, it brings forth sin. And sin, when it has grown up, brings forth death. That is all that hate can bring. I've never seen hate bring anything else other than death. Because if you hate and you resent long enough, one day you're going to snap. And you're going to do something bad. And you're going to take life that you never gave. But if we love, we can overcome hate and show families who are hurting that there is hope in this world, that we do not have to be down and out because of what we see around us. There is hope. For we know there are some who can take our body, but the Bible tells us, I fear better to fear the one who can take both body and soul in hell. So, I encourage you to pray for those families that we'll come in contact with. And those families that need our help right here. Because there's a lot of pain. There's a lot of hate. There's a lot of hurt going on in our world. But we know that God is still on the throne. And He gives us hope. So Jesus is speaking. And the Bible tells us that while he was speaking, he was interrupted. Now, if we read the Bible long enough, we know that it's not good to interrupt God while he's speaking. Hello, somebody. So Jesus is speaking and he's interrupted by friends who mean well, family who means well. And they have something to tell Jesus. Isn't it interesting how they're on the outside and shouting to the inside that they have something to tell Jesus? I think that's amazing. It's kind of like us. When we want to do what we want to tell God how we want to do it. Hello, somebody. We're standing on the outside and we want to tell him what we want to say. But we're not on the inside listening to what he is currently saying. Very important message. They were missing it because they thought that what they had to say was so important that they had an interest for his well-being. They thought he was losing it. And Jesus says, you know, identify the family? How do I identify the family? He says, these, my disciples, those are my brothers, my sisters, and my mother. He says, anyone who does the will of God, they're part of the family. Thank God for his family. We can choose to do the will of God today. We can choose to get out of our places of fear and our places of burden and choose to serve God and to do his will. And then we'll know what it really feels like to be in the family of God. But I want to give you, as we close, the last piece, which is hope for the hurting families. Because there is hope. Hello, somebody. There is hope. It's not all destruction, because when we read the book of Micah and we see the destruction that God is promising on his people because they've forgotten about him. They've gone wrong. They've just left God and just gone in their own way. But as God always does, he leaves a remnant. A few faithful ones. A few that he can count on to rebuild while the building is being torn down. There is hope. Because the Bible tells us that God doesn't want any to perish, but he hopes that all should come to repentance. The Bible tells us that we are neither Jew nor Greek, bond nor free, male nor female. God has already torn down the walls that men are trying to build. Hello, somebody. And it doesn't matter what walls men put up, God's kingdom would live over that wall. Paul tells it about tearing down the middle wall of partition. He was talking about the temple, because in the temple back then there was the court for the Gentiles and then the court for the Jews. They didn't intermingle. But Paul writes this even before the walls came down, that God had torn down the middle wall of partition by sending Christ. We have hope in Christ. No matter where you come from, no matter who you are, no matter what you did yesterday, God still wants you to be part of his family. Just remember as we go that whatever we sow is what we're going to reap. If we sow division, it can only bring division. If we sow hate, bring hate and death. So evil, don't we produce it? More evil. But if we sow love, if we sow love, if we sow hope, if we sow forgiveness, if we sow mercy, if we sow grace, it will all bear fruit and be good unto God. So I give you hope this morning that these trying times will not last always. Jesus knew it. The truth is, he's given us hope for the bad things to come. There's more. But the hope is that we spread the word to enough who need to hear it. So that when the bad happens, we don't have to care about what happens with our bodies, because our souls are saved forevermore. And we can rest easy, knowing that we are saved in Christ. I encourage you this morning, if you hear, you're hurting this morning, come down. We need to pray. I want to encourage our leaders to come up after and pray for our nation. Pray for the families in pain.
Amen.
Not just them, but pray for the children who've been separated from their families, who don't even know who they belong to. Just pray for our world and our nation. Because there are many who need hope today that only God can bring.
Yes.
If you hear this morning, you want to find hope in Christ. If you heard the word this morning and you believe it, it's in the Bible, and I want to encourage you to go back and read it. God's word, it's not what you see out in the world. He has a different message for you. He has a message of hope, a message of love, a message of forgiveness. He can forgive you if you want him to repent this morning, until you be baptized into Christ and be raised to walk in newness of life and to remain faithful and make disciples also. Why not come right now as we stand and as we stand?